bridges. Tomorrow's sun will build a great sky. I love this country dearly. I can feel the light of me. But I never thought I'd be alone to try. Once I was outside the station, selling land in the incarnation. We were spending all of my life and I. Before me and then we saved all our money from my dear wife or the. Now I want to bring my family stateside. But after four they stayed a while and scattered across the coast. Once a year I'll see them for a week or so.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back Graham McBain.
When we come and do it, think it's genie. We work for the paper, so there'll never be a beanie. Lyrics are a wonder because we got it by the man.
Hello. Hello. Bueller. All right, there we go. Hi. Yeah, you don't need to stand for me, but thank you. I'm just super thankful for all of you to be here. It's so fun to see. I know a lot of you just from the community and meeting you here, and to get to see you all connecting is like the coolest thing ever. I see like two really smart people I know meet, and I'm like, I just want to listen to that conversation. So it's really cool to get to see that happen. And then our next panel is like all of those people combined having a cool conversation. So I'm just excited for you all to be here and, you know, watch it all together. So Jason Heinrichs, let's welcome him up and the panelists for the Build versus Buy panel.
10 years ago, I used to listen to rappers flow, talking about the way they rock the mic at the disco. I like how that stuff was going down. Dreamt about ripping the mic with my own sound. So I tried to write rhymes something like them. My boy said that ain't you. I stuff sounds like them.
I thought we were gonna walk up one at a time.
Nah, I don't do that. Sorry. All right, so this panel is actually the result of Shamir and I shitposting in a Moov channel about how easy fintechs have it today. I mean, back when we got started, 2008, 2010, there were no APIs connecting you to an issuer. In fact, there were no issuers doing banking as a service. Now, Graham tried to quell the cranky old guys and said, hey, you know what, you're the OG. But what he doesn't understand is when you're old enough, that doesn't mean the original gangster. It just means you're the old guy. I mean, back when Shamir and I got started, when we sent an ACH file, we sent it in the mail. Our first card issuer was Hallmark. When we had to file a SAR, we walked uphill both ways. So, that brings us to today. Wow, has the industry changed. You don't know how easy you have it. Actually, I don't know if it's any easier. It's just more complex. But there are two things that are still true when you think about build versus buy. First is, with infinite time and infinite money, anybody can build anything. Except who knows the number one reason that startups fail? They run out of money, right? So I'm excited to share with this panel. We have some people who've been at it for a long time, some people who've been at it an equally long time, but have the benefit of a more modern architecture, talking about what is it to build versus buy. And unfortunately, there is no NFT that allows you to buy now and build later. Shamir, why don't we kick off with you? Let's go back to the first days of Simple. How did you even approach, you know, the archaic technology and begin to decide what to do for build versus buy?
Well, I like to say that we did everything wrong before we did it right. So initially, and remember, the backstory for Simple was that I was based in Brussels, and my co-founder was in New York, and he sent me an email saying, let's start a retail bank, and you'll see how crazy I am that in 2009, I thought that that was a great idea, and I was like, yeah, I'm in. I moved back to the U.S., and every year between 2000 and 2008, there were 100 to 300 new banks chartered in the U.S. From 2008 to now, I think it's been less than 10 in total. So the FDIC hung out a big close for business sign, and you couldn't get a charter. And that was the original plan when I came back to the U.S. And then quickly realized that wasn't going to work. So like, okay, let's go talk to some of the bank technology vendors and let's try and find a partner bank and let's figure out how to make this happen. I still vividly remember the, I'm not sure if it was a Fiserv or FIS sales rep, and he was telling us about how their tech could do everything. And I was like, this is great. What are your API docs? And he was like, what is an API? I'm like, this is 2010. You don't know the meaning of the word API. So we went through a bunch of different vendors, eventually landed with TXVIA, which was a prepaid card issuer. We talked to so many banks. At one point, we had term sheets from three banks, and then two of them got cease and desist letters from the regulators, so we were left with one bank, and then eventually signed with that one bank, because that was the entire choice, right? You can go live with Bancorp, or you can not go live at all. So we went live with Bancorp, right? And help them figure out, like I think you guys did as well at Berk Street, like what this new industry actually was, because they had a prepaid business and they had a wealth management business. They had no idea that there could be a business that was actually kind of the combination of the two, but it was core deposits, but it was with the technology of the prepaid space.
Well, and that's where Dan and I started, right? So when we launched Berk Street and closed on our first round, you know, the backstory I was sharing with you guys, there was no issuing bank, right? So Dan and I drew up a list of 200, 300 banks, and it was like boiler room, right? We're probably, hello, I'd like to talk to you about an issuing bank business and opportunity. Extended warranty, maybe? No? And, you know, building those first integrations were some of the hardest parts. Now, Maya, when you stepped into it, you know, maybe we talked, you know, with Pinch first. The world had evolved, but when you started to think about, you know, the build versus buy, like, were you cognizant of, like, there's an intentionality here of, like, I can rent everything, I can buy everything?
So. And my philosophy is to truly buy as much as possible. And sometimes that surprises people about me because I have an engineering background. And so they think, oh, you have an engineering background. You probably want to build your own things. And I'm like, no. I have an engineering background, so I want to buy other people's work. And I think it was a real mistake that I made in my first startup, as I was so excited about building and creating new things, and I felt so powerful that I designed, I mean, this extremely extensive warehouse management system that I just so much for a rental a business, and it was way too much, and it was so much work just to maintain that system, that then for my second startup, I was like, there are experts in the space, we should focus our building on connecting existing products and really buying as much as we can.
Zach, within H&M Bradley, how do you think about the build versus buy, and who owns it? Like, where does decision-making lie for you?
Yeah, I like to buy as long as my co-founder doesn't negotiate the price. I think ultimately we kind of look at everything from a time and materials like cost perspective as well. And so it's kind of like diving down to the metal of if we build this, what will it cost us truly? Mm-hmm. What will the maintenance cost us? And so I think as we've grown, I've kind of now started looking at myself and, you know, the lieutenants around, you know, our management team is like, just basically capital allocators. Where are we allocating this capital? Is it going to be to people or to services? If we allocate it in the people, like, will it actually pay dividends or not? If we allocate it in the services, is that going to be the best experience for the customer? And so for us, it's really like, if we can do something that will affect the customer's life in a better way, and we think that we can only do it by building it, we will. Otherwise, we're probably going to buy it.
Well, that's an important thread to pull on, right, is what am I going to own? Shamir, back to you in the first days. What did you decide is simple you wanted to own?
The customer interface. We had to build a website. We had to build the mobile apps and everything that the customer touched and the customer support, right? Like, we built our entire customer support team in-house based in Portland. And, in fact, me and Josh and the business team moved from New York to Portland so that we could be right next door in the same room with customer service. Josh used to take customer service calls, and I used to take them too for a long time. We were like, the customer experience is what matters the most, and we need to innovate around it. But to build that, you need a platform underneath, which didn't exist. And so we had to buy pieces that we could and then connect them all together and watch it break like on a at least monthly basis, and then like fix it behind the scenes rapidly before customers discovered it. I learned so many interesting things. The Fed goes down, in case you guys didn't know. it happened earlier this year, actually, but yeah, it has happened like twice in the last decade.
So tell us more about those trade-offs, because I think that's what people sometimes miss, is if you choose to build in what you're going to own, there always has to be a trade-off when you squeeze that balloon.
I mean, at the end, we were just so desperate to ship, right? We had a waiting list of 200,000 people, and pretty much the entire industry had written us off as vaporware. Because remember, we started in July of 2009 and launched in July of 2012, so 3 years. And so
I remember being on that wait list for a long time.
A long time. The funny part is how good the conversion was on the wait list, even after people had been waiting like years. And then we finally just cut scope to like the bare minimum, shipped it, started. The first month we had 7,000 users, and then we couldn't onboard any more because our partner bank's backend systems just broke, and we were like, we have to slow this down. We have to find how many we can onboard that they can deal with, and then onboard at that rate. And then a couple of months after we launched, we were like, wait, we're getting all these customers to sign up, and everybody puts in $100, $200 and swipes their card when they get it, and so activity rises and then just collapses, right? And we were like, our activation rate was like abysmal, and we were just begun to measure it, right? And then we put together a team and we started doing A/B testing and built like so much around that, and we basically doubled our activation rate from September of 12 to March of 13, which that meant like a 5x increase in profitability. Right, like that's how much it mattered. And that had nothing to do with the backend infrastructure, which was still totally broken, and there was a whole massive team just trying to keep it running. This was all like UI improvements, like building onboarding workflows, email, like tweaking the product, and this and that. And that was actually the most valuable thing we could have done in those first like 12 months, is get the product market fit by optimizing the customer experience across the entire product. And then at the end, we had to like, you know, swap out a bunch of backend stuff, and you know, our partner got acquired by Google, so then we had to switch partners, and then we got acquired by a bank. So all that stuff happened, but being able to focus on that front end experience and innovate on it, I mean, that's what you need to get to as soon as possible.
So Maya, what have you chosen to own, and what was the trade off related, you know, to that?
Yeah, I think time certainly feels the same way about owning that customer experience and creating something really powerful there. For us, you know, what I always say about this stuff is, like, if it's not a competitive differentiator, don't invest in it. Like, just buy something off the shelf and then put all of your time and money and energy into the stuff that makes you a competitive differentiator and really moves the needle. I think for time, though, it's now at the scale where some things have moved from the table stakes bucket into starting to really matter. So historically, I would have said, you know, time has all these amazing value props, but some stuff like ACH processing, it's like, it's not a competitive differentiator. It kind of just works. Our processor does it for us. It's just off the shelf.
Well, in theory, it just works, but
In theory,
it just works.
But one of Time's core value props is that people who set a payroll direct deposit get paid up to 2 days early. And so, actually, the way that we process ACHs is a competitive differentiator, and it's actually quite important. And so, we've actually invested quite a bit into that process and that experience. And so, that's been, you know, slowly over time, like building more of that in-house instead of just relying on our processor.
I'm so pissed about that. I can remember the meeting I had with a banker in like 2011, and they randomly had like an ACH accredited professional, and I discussed the whole like payroll deposit with him, and he explained the rules to me and why you can legally actually do 2 day early direct deposit. I was like, oh, we should go do this at Simple, and we never fucking did. And here China is.
It's really, really powerful. It, you know, for people who are living paycheck to paycheck, it often can make the
it's
difference.
Huge.
And,
yeah.
It's huge.
I mean, I get it now, and I still like it. It doesn't matter to me.
So I want to push on that a little bit. Isn't it a one-time phase shift, right? Like, it pulls it forward 2 days, but then, like, from then on, what do you do the next month, right? Because you're used to living 2 days earlier on your paycheck to paycheck.
So I think there's a couple of different things. I think if most weeks you're fine getting your paycheck on Friday, but even though it comes on Wednesday or Thursday, right, then you're just fine. Like, you're normally fine. Mm-hmm. And then that 1 week where you really need it, then it's there for you a couple days early. And so that's where we start to see some of the advantages there. I think there's also a social component, like a keeping up with the Joneses. So we're all friends with our coworkers. We talk to our coworkers. If you get your paycheck earlier than your coworkers and you all work at the same place, like, you're able to, you know, go buy the things you need in your life a little bit earlier and, like,
go talk shit
better.
Oh, this was amazing to me in the early Simple data. Was like the number of people making good money, right? Like having 10K plus net deposited into their bank accounts, who they have 10K at the start of the month, end of the month they have $20.
Oh, I had to counsel one of those women when they changed the overdraft rules, right? Like I had to explain we were taking her overdraft away. Turns out she's an investment banker making $120,000 and told me to go F off. She's going to spend her money the way she wants to.
Right. And so it's even for people who have money, getting it 2 days early is massively valuable. And even for those for whom it's not valuable, they still like it.
I was going to say, you said you get your paycheck 2 days early.
And I still like it. I mean, I don't notice much of the time. No, I don't.
Zach, you don't have to explain if you're living paycheck to paycheck. But where have you decided, H.M. Bradley, like, this is the space we need to own and we're going to build and invest in? What was the trade-off?
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because what Shamir said is exactly what I used to tell. We as a processor, that's First Data or now Fiserv, which was a very weird choice for a startup, right? But in the early days, they would ask me, well, we have this product or that product. And what I would usually say is, if the customer sees it and touches it, we are going to build it. And if they don't, I don't care. And that's sort of how we like kind of measured it. It's like, if I can make this experience better for the customer in any way, shape, or form, I want to do that. Otherwise, like, not, I mean, we would never build a ledger, for instance. That's one of the things that I always talk about is, like, just use a core system because a ledger is a thankless job. When you run the ledger properly, no one notices. And when you don't run the ledger properly, everyone notices. And so, like, you don't want that job.
A thankless job?
So it's just, like, that's kind of our, you know, our version is, like, look, we want to affect the customer experience, and that's what we care about, but nothing else really is important to us around, like, there's no pride of ownership in what we're building versus what we're buying. It's really about what the customer is getting from it.
Well, too often, though, this, like, customer experience is we need to build prettier stuff, right? It's that my proverbial digital lipstick on the analog pig. And my, I think you at Chime suffer the most from this because everyone kind of looks at what you're doing and it's like, oh, we'll just go do that too. So how do you begin to differentiate the experience in a world of, you know, fast followers?
Oh, well, I'm actually not worried about that because, so everyone, I see Chime's homepage everywhere. Everyone seems to have copied the Chime homepage and it's not about the homepage. So they're kind of welcome to copy that homepage. You know, I don't know that how many people are even visiting that. So I don't worry about that too much. The lipstick on the pig thing, and I think it's really coming up now. It's like, well, if everyone's building on lipstick or unit, are we just buying the same product from lots of different skins on it? But in part, and my talk later, is I think we need more lipstick on the pig. And I'm worried that, like, really we've invested so much in advertising. And it's like we have all these billboards on the road that are like, come see our pig. And then the pig is quite ugly. And I'm almost like, you know, let's get some lipstick. Like, this is, I don't know, does the pig have hair? Like, can we do something with the fur? Or, you know, like, I feel like the pig could look a little better if we're driving so many people to it.
And let's be clear, like, everything is, nobody just says, hey, it's all just built on the internet. So, I mean, everybody needs underlying infrastructure. And we are, the best infrastructure basically just gets standardized and used by everybody. But nobody says, hey, listen, Instagram and TikTok are just basically the same because they're just putting lipstick on the internet, right? No, there are massive differentiation in, like, the tiny interactions of the app, right? And there is a huge amount of value there if you invest in it. And the real question is, like, how do you invest in it and how do you actually build that differentiated customer experience? Infrastructure is readily available nowadays. I mean, I still think there's a lot of improvement to happen on the infrastructure side. It's but there's much more available now than 10 years ago. But the quality of the interfaces, I think there's a lot of improvements to that.
Well, so building on your analogy, right, if you look at Instagram and TikTok and Snap, like, they're all basically the same except they solve different problems for their users. And if we, like, play at what industry do we know where everyone uses the same infrastructure providers and then offers the same product? Oh, yeah, banking, right? Like, they all look the same. Are we in danger of, like, this next crop of fintechs if we're all building on the same and not rethinking what the unique value proposition is? Do we just recreate banking?
But the distribution was different. Even up until, like, 3-4 years ago, the biggest, like, way that people in the U.S. picked their bank was proximity. Like, which bank branch is closest to me? They're so similar, Chase versus BofA, that I can't be bothered to cross the street. There's a BofA branch on this side, I'm sticking with BofA, right? So you built more branches, and you just tried to saturate the place, and it was all branch-based. On the internet, it doesn't matter, right? Like, there might be some land grab in, like, you know, top of the rankings and the App Store or the Play Store, stuff like that. But it's really, like, you can invest so much money in marketing, but everybody will learn those techniques and catch up with you eventually. The thing that really can be a sustainable differentiator is if you can build a product that speaks to customers. And if you do, they will stick with you. I mean, when Simple got shut down by BBVA earlier this year, what surprised me was the number of customers on Reddit and in other places who are like, yeah, I signed up 8 years ago. I love this product. I'm so pissed that it's going away. I'm like, wow, that loyal fan base was planning to stick with this product till they died and had nowhere else to go.
Well, I think this is one of the really powerful parts of the internet, right? Like, if you have a very niche interest, you've been to underwater basket weaving, right? It's like you can find other, there might not
be. But do we need a bank of underwater basket weaving?
Well, as you know, we have H.M. Bradley. Like,
damn it, I didn't know I had to get into basket weaving.
Is that what I need to do to get an invite, is show my basket weaving? Well, let's talk about, Brian, I want to build on that. So when you think about H.M. Bradley, what is the core value, like the unique insight that you're have to build against that you can't buy somewhere else?
Like, I think for us, it was really about, if you talk to a bank and you say, what do you want? A banker will probably tell you, I want a stable deposit base and I want it to be growing. And if you talk to a customer and you say, what do you want? They'll probably say, I just want to make more money on my money. And for whatever reason, for the last 100 years, I think bankers have thought those two things are diametrically opposed. And our belief was like, they don't have to be. What if we just paid you more when you helped us do what we want to do, which is grow a stable deposit base? And so what we do is we pay customers when they save more of what's coming in. And we never segment by how many dollars you have, because banking, by the way, is the only industry in the world where you walk in and you say, how do you segment your customers? And they go, oh, if you got 100 grand, you can have this. And if you got a million, you can have that. Like, it's bizarre. Like, what a Byzantine system. So I think for us, yeah.
It's a system in which, in many cases, the poor subsidize the rich.
Absolutely. Yeah. So, Maya, how does Chime do it at scale? Because, like, you are now of, you know, call it a, you know, the Chase or the BOFAs of the neobanks. How do you still find a unique value proposition to deliver against?
Yeah, and I think, like, Chime is by far the largest company that I've worked at, and so it's, like, a very new experience.
How many employees is it now?
1,000.
Wow.
Yeah.
And so I think, you know, when I think about the build versus buy thing, it's like in the early stages, everything you can do to get to market fastest and find product market fit, right? And then at some point, as you need to be a good business, you know, and you maybe start picking up more margin by building things. It's very different at Chime stage. So at Chime stage, whenever we look at possible partners, all we see is risk and, like, what risk they would bring onto our product, right?
And risk and cost, but those are, in many ways, the same thing.
Yeah. Yeah. And so it's like when we think about, like, our reliability and being able to grow and, you know, like, protecting our customer data and, like, all these things that are, like, now, like, quite important, it makes that buy decision look, like, pretty unattractive.
Zach. Any regrets on the build versus buy? Like, when you look at, you know, wish we hadn't X.
Are you opening this up for a joke about a bank partner right now, or? Sorry.
No holds barred.
I mean, look, I think ultimately you end up regretting a handful of things, and if you don't, you're probably lying to yourself. I think for us, you know, there's a slew. Everyone here is in fintech, so. You know, last month they had every month there was a new company that 10 people started at the same time and called it something different. One of those months was payroll APIs, and we famously chose the wrong one and then rolled that decision back. So that was fun. So yeah, I think there's a handful of things always, but nothing that was like detrimental. I mean, it's funny, like one of my biggest problems right now, I was telling this to our investors the other day, it's like, The problem that we have is, like, our whole team wakes up every day assuming every chart is still going up and to the right, because it has since the day we launched. Mm-hmm. And that's actually a terrifying problem to have as a founder, because you're trying to keep them motivated knowing it's not going to keep doing this. Like, it doesn't always go this way. And so much of, like, when we're thinking about those decisions is really, like, what's going to keep driving the growth that we have, and how do we keep doing that? And so, you know, it's a lot of the trade-offs that you're making are trying to keep doing that, but also at the back of your mind, you have to think, like, we still have to make money here. Like, there's a business behind this.
The competitive advantage of fear, right? They're running out of money, right? Like, yeah. I will sometimes tell our bank partners that they lack the competitive advantage of desperation, which startups have, you know, in spades, right? Which is, if I don't figure this out, we go out of business. Maya, any build versus buy regrets?
Oh, so many. but one of them, you know, I was actually, like, hyper aware of the build versus buy trade-offs in the early days of Pinch. And so I thought I was doing something that would be very clever, which is that we embarked on getting a relationship with Cross River Bank, which is a wonderful partner, great reputation, does a lot of lending for startups. And in our mind, we were like, this is going to take a long time. Like, this is going to be like a several years long process to work with kind of like the best in class lending partner for startups. And I knew how important it was to get to market quickly, start providing customer value, iterating on that, find out, you know, how you're going to acquire customers and all those pieces. And so we thought, we were like, okay, the fastest way to launch is going to be to sign up with Synapse. Mm-hmm. And so we jumped on signing up with Synapse at the same time as embarking on this relationship with CrossRever. And in my head, I'm going to launch with Synapse now, find out a bunch of data, like refine the UI and the product experience and all that things, and then would be able to plug in CrossRever and switch people over sometimes later. Mm-hmm. Well, for a variety of things that are hard to predict, because that's how startups are, the Synapse launch got delayed and delayed and delayed and delayed, and CrossRever happened much earlier than we expected, so that we got approval for both in like the same week. And we had kind of just done twice as much work for no benefit, which per startups running out of cash and stuff is like a very dangerous position to be in the early stage. And so we ended up just launching on CrossRever since we had it. But we had, you know, it's like the contracts, and we paid Synapse a gazillion dollars, and we had written all this code to integrate with their APIs, and we had done all the work. And so that feels like a mistake somewhere.
I mean, it's funny because we did maybe a slightly smarter version of the same thing. I mean, at Scylla, we built the alpha on top of Synapse because we were like, hey, I want to get something out there. But I always was aware of the fact that this probably won't work long term. It was surprising how quickly it didn't work. And then we signed up with Evolve and switched to them. But we designed the system so we could actually do that. And it was always on the books from day one.
Oh, to do the seamless switchover.
Exactly. And so we actually kept most of our kind of code base, and we didn't have to rewrite everything because we did design with that in mind from the start.
Yeah.
And still, I think we should have just gone straight to Evolve and skip that step. Because, I mean, they're a platform, right? And for a platform, you need your own ledger. You need your direct bank
integration. But isn't this like, weren't you just saying go to market as fast as possible and cut scope?
So I think there's a difference here, right? Like, Scylla is a platform business, right? If they're an API platform to program with money, customers rely on us to be, like, super reliable. And honestly, I would like to have a master account at the Fed and cut everybody out between me and the core bank.
You won't tell Evolve, you just said that.
No, I talk to Scott all the time about it. Like, I'm good with him, man. I'm on their advisory board. The thing is, that's like a 10-year plan, right? So in the meantime, we all need bank partners. And at least for platform businesses, I think it's a different equation of build versus buy.
I think you're right. And this is kind of back to Ohad's talk this morning, where he's talking about, like, look, if you're tackling big, hairy problems, you have to do it differently, and it's going to be a longer time scale, and you have to be a mature organization. It has to be reliable, like all those different things. Like, I think, yeah, the point at which you shift things from build versus buy is going to be different.
And even at Scylla, right, like we partner with Alloy, we partner with Plaid, we partner with Lithic, and there's probably six others I'm forgetting. But like as much of it that we could avoid having to build, I still avoided building. We build the core ledger, the wallet, and kind of the layering above it. But,
oh, ledger, I hear that's a thankless business.
yes, I would agree. It is a thankless business. But you can't
Well, except sure. when it empowers switching, right? Because I think, let's pull on this right for a second. There's something important around in the build versus buy when I'm ready from someone, I need to be prepared to switch. And you know, when we were talking about the way back earlier, Shamir, the things people don't know. So when we launched Perk Street, at the time we raised a whopping round of $6 million, but there was only one catch. We only got the first $3 million up front. We had to actually prove that we could go do something that no one ever had done before, which is partner with a bank that counted as core deposits to stand up a technology to acquire customers for less than $350, right? And you know, hint, we kind of cut a bunch of corners along the way. But you know, where you chose to own the experience, we couldn't afford to. We didn't have enough money, and our experience was crap. Like, in our activation, our only benefit is, since we gave money away in the forms of rewards, you can get people to put up with a lot of crap. But where we failed, and I think you succeeded in this, is we had baked in that we could take over our own technology at some point, and Bancorp would just be an issuing bank. Executing that when you have 100,000 customers was like a near impossible feat. So I'm curious how, you know, Zach, I'll start with you, when you're like, you think of these I might have to switch partner moments.
Yeah.
How do you know when it's time to switch, and how do you actually do it? Because it's worse than breaking up.
Yeah. First of all, I feel like the curmudgeon here, because am I the only person in fintech that thinks launching fast is bullshit? Like, it's actually almost never accretive to your business long term to just get some shitty product to market. You know, so it's like, I don't know.
Well, everyone had a shitty term sheet that you run out of money if we had actually launched.
With your case, I get it. But, like, with, you know, like, I mean, even Shamir, you talking about, like, rushing to market with some apps, like, Snaps in the audience, I'm sorry, but I've told so many founders, like, don't go that route. Like, go and do this the right way and think about the product and who you're actually building it for, because that actually does matter.
I mean, when you're buying, buy best in class, right? And even if it takes layering 2-3 together, buy best in class and take the extra 2 to 3 months to do that.
Yeah. The skill that they have is, I mean, this is like objectively good advice, but it's extremely expensive. Like, buy best in class is very expensive.
It is.
And your plan about build it so that you could swap out any, like, just realistically, that's going to take like 10 times as long to build than if you're like, what is just the thing that works and gets it. Like,
maybe an extra 6-8 months, but that is still 6-8
yeah.
months
for a
seed start.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, the longest part of us building the first version of Major Bradley was actually designing the database schemas, right? Trying to figure out, how are we going to have this go multi-core at some point? How are we going to run Omnibus accounts? Knowing that we were going to have that problem at some point, but I mean, we spent probably 3 months just designing the databases.
But saying, like, how's this going
to
work?
Slow to move fast. Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, you know, I tell our team all the time, like, if I'm the guy that goes on vacation with absolutely no itinerary. But if you don't have a plan, you cannot build a product. You know, you have to have a plan. And so sometimes it does. Like, if you slow down and you're just the right way, and like the way that, you know, we do things is not the way that everyone should do things. But, you know, we start from the end. We start from a press release or a customer
release. Launch fast. I don't think you have a plan. I think you have to have like a vision of the experience you want to create, and then you listen to customers and iterate along the way.
Yeah. And also remember, we're all VC funded startups here. Right? So we are on that treadmill. You have to produce results within 18 months, otherwise that next round isn't coming. And honestly, in this environment, right, like one of the components of build versus buy is cost. And none of us even cares. Because it's like, why costs don't matter until you're like, you're a unicorn. So for Chime, it's a big thing now. Right. Risk and cost and everything, because at some point you guys want to be profitable and go public and exactly.
Money,
right. But until you're within, like, you know, shooting distance of that IPO, just raise a little bit more money and get there a little bit faster. Is
oh, how the world has changed.
Jason, I feel you, man. I feel you. You and I know how different it was.
Oh, God. Someone pulled the arrows out of the back.
Just raise more money, Jason. It's not that hard.
Just go raise it. What are you doing? I mean, when we raised our Series B, ad nauseum on our unit economics and, like, how are you going to actually, you know, make this into a profitable business in time to pay back. And now it's like,
and I know one company last year raised a Series B, it was well over $20 million in 3 days. So I feel like they didn't really dive into the unit economics on that. Literally, that is enough hours.
I mean, at one point, I think Dan and I were both afraid we were going to end up in divorces when we were raising our Series B, because we were doing the, hey, we were going to happen to be, you know, in Menlo Park if you can meet. Oh, when are you going to be there? Tuesday? Are you free Tuesday or Wednesday? Oh, we have to be in Atlanta? Oh, we can be there on Wednesday.
I mean, of the three co-founders of Simple, all of us were married in 2010. All of us are married now. I'm the only one married to the same woman.
I mean, the hidden cost, right? And that's not to, as you said, glorify. You know,
yeah, I mean, I was there. I mean, lived alongside that. None of that shit was pleasant, but there are costs.
Yeah. The hidden cost. So let's go into the, like, the, what is the kind of market perception around this that you kind of want to, like, pop the balloon on? Because one is, like, to yours, everything always goes up and to the right. Like, I remember at one point when we were in the sales process and people were like, oh, how's it going to purchase? I'm like, we're killing it. like, literally, we're killing it right now. Like, the business is being killed right now. So, you know, that was the culture. Everything's up and to the right, and you can't blink. And so what piece of advice, or, you know, would you look at and say, you know, that is, like, the bullshit in how we view fintech right now, because, you know, it is all up and to the right.
Oh, man, so many things. I'm just going to have to pick one.
We'll go down the line. We'll come back. You go
first.
Yeah,
like, I do think, you know, I'm not the first person to think this, but there's so much hype and investor enthusiasm right now for fintech infrastructure. And there is a bit of a question, like, just who exactly is going to be buying all of this infrastructure? Like, for there to be, you know, a dozen different options for each thing, there's not that many people who are, like, would be
the thing is, there are a dozen options, but not all of them are good. But there are at least now, like, two or three good options.
This is always buy best in class, you know.
But they've each gone out.
There's a little bit more money on buy best in class.
Or that.
Oh, come on. I mean, you're totally right. Like, it's funny. I was in infrastructure years ago, and I was building a Plaid competitor that did not work out nearly as well as Plaid, clearly. And I walked into meetings with blue chip VCs where the first thing they would say is, I already passed on Plaid. Yoli's 15 years old. It hasn't gone public. There's no business here. And, you know, I think that actually, for me, built a lot of conviction in my own belief in myself. Because now, like, thank God I have it, because we're a consumer, and everyone's like, oh, you're not an infrastructure company? We only back infrastructure companies now. You're like, when I was in infrastructure, you didn't want to back that. Like,
yeah, it's all cyclical, man. And the one thing I will say is, like, don't buy into your own hype. Right? Like, your job as a founder is to generate all the freaking hype you can, right? You're always killing it, no matter what happens, right? And you have to do that, because it's almost like you have to create this reality distortion field around yourself and just carry everybody along until that reality distortion becomes reality, right? Or it doesn't.
That's why I got married, actually. She pops that distortion field all the time.
My wife really helps with this. I understand that. But like, don't buy into it yourself, right? Like, you have to know you're generating all this hype, but don't end up like Holmes where you actually believe it yourself. And you're like, you need to know what the real metrics of the business are and keep track of them. And you need to be quite strategic about things like this, right? Why am I doing build versus buy, right? What will change in 2 or 3 years? I'm going to buy now, I'm going to scale, I'm going to get my CAC and LTV, and once I get the Series B or C, then I'm going to say, rethink all of this, right? And the more, like, you know, you always have to be looking almost like 2 rounds ahead and being like, this next round I'll get with these metrics, but the one after that might not be on these. So what are those metrics going to be?
I feel like we should have done this panel as buy versus sell, and we could have just talked about what we thought was going to work and what we thought was going to fail. That would have been way more fun.
Well, let's play with that then for a second, right? Because I can go back to when Dan and I launched PerkStreet, we did all these focus groups. So I was coming from the student lending business. We launched a student bank. He was running the debit business at Capital One. We did focus groups with recent college grads. And we're like, hey, we're going to put cash-like rewards on debit cards. And I'm like, that's amazing. Do you know who didn't sign up for our PerkStreet cards? Like, none of those mofos in the focus group, right? Like, there's nothing worse than your two founders calling, like, why haven't you signed up for this card yet? And then we're looking at the data, and they're showing us, like, some people are buying it and, like, using the card way more than we expected. Like, so we, in our first segment, like, our second cohort, we were seeing average monthly spend of $1,200 on a debit card, right? And we're like, who are you? Well, it turns out it's not recent college grads. It's mothers in the suburbs, right? And so it's like, goodbye, sexy Apple Store, you know, partnership. Hello, diapers.com. So I'd love to know more of those stories on, like, the when you thought you were going to build towards something and it turned out to not be the right thing. Maya, why don't we start with you?
Yeah, easy. I have a ton of examples. And this is why I'm a fan of launching early. So at Pinch, the reason I started Pinch is I was at Roxbox and I was running, like, customer lifetime, NPS score, LTV, churn and retention. And I started really digging into all of our retention numbers and doing customer interviews. And that was where I realized Americans' finances need a lot of help. And the stories were just, I mean, I was a little naive to it before then, to be fully transparent. But the stories were so compelling. And I talked to so many people who said, oh, you know, like, I love Roxbox. I love your product. I've hit the credit limit on my credit card, which is why the charges aren't going through. But if you just wait until the first of the month, that's when I get paid and I pay it down and the charge will go through then. And I was like, good Lord. And so I got really interested in this problem. I wanted to solve this problem. And I was like, look, my background's software. So I'm probably not going to go do job training or anything like that, but I want to use software to help Americans become more financially stable. And we didn't know what that would look like. And so the first product that we launched actually was a modified property casualty insurance product that was really kind of a hybrid of an insurance product and a loan that covered the financial shocks that Americans are more likely to face today. So it's stuff like your car breaking down and your car getting towed. Maybe unexpected, like some unexpected medical expenses. It's like the things that insurance doesn't cover, but really start that downward spiral where if you can't pay to get your car at the tow yard, you can't drive to work. Can't drive to work, then you really don't have $200, and then it's just down from there. So we wanted to do that. Very academically interesting product. You know, customers hated it. Like, no one wants to buy extra insurance. And, in fact, the customers we were targeting, like, not all of them even had auto insurance, which is illegal. So there really wasn't a fit there. And that's why we saw that. And everyone said, everyone we talked to, like your focus groups, everyone was like, oh, that's a really cool product. Like, it's a really cool idea. Like,
I will never be a customer. But
never be, right. You're like, somebody should sign up for that. But when we switched, right, so we found, we ended up switching doing some financial inclusion stuff and primarily reporting rent payments to the credit bureaus so people build their credit score just by paying their rent. Then when I told people about it, people take out their phones and say, like, oh, I have to sign up. Or, like, and we have to send this to my sister. Or, like, here, will you talk to my sister and, like, get her to sign? You know, it was such a difference. Like, and I feel like that's something that's really stuck in my head is anytime people say, like, oh, that's such a cool idea, it means it's a terrible idea and no one will use it. And anytime they're like, how do I sign up now? That's a good idea. And so that was a big learning for me.
Yeah. Well, in part of this, though, is everything you just described is nothing about the technology. It's all about you had to own the product market fit. Yeah?
Very much so.
Yeah. Sure.
Well, that's funny because, like, we did a lot of the same things at Simple. Right? Like, the whole idea behind Simple was to help people manage their money, spend smarter and save more. And we did, like, the first 18 months or so, everybody who signed up on the wait list, Josh and I would email them. And so we had like 10,000 email conversations with people. And people sat down and wrote out like 6 or 7 page emails about everything that they hated about their bank. And we would put it on the walls of the office and everything. And so we designed a lot of the tools and simple like goals and everything else to help with that. And that actually worked, right? It was transformational. I think a lot of people now do similar, like, built-in savings tools, right? But then one of the things that we built, which always surprises me even now, like, we added this capability to attach a photo to a transaction. And the whole idea behind it was we already had hashtags, which you could search by. So we were like, you attach a photo to a transaction, hashtag it expense, and then search by expense, print that off, and that's your expense report. You can just hand it to somebody, right? And that was the thought process behind that idea. We looked at it like 6 months after it shipped, and not even 10% of the photos that people attached had anything to do with like a receipt. It was mostly food. Food was the single biggest category. And then there was everything else, photos of people with their dogs and this and that. And they're like, this looks more like Instagram than like Expensify. Yeah. Why are people attaching these photos to their bank? And that's when they realized that like the two things that matter the most to people is like health and wealth, right? And there's this whole movement around like quantified self and like, you know, with these wristbands and Apple Watches to help you manage your health better. But none of that stuff existed in the wealth space. And when you actually help people manage their finances better, you start like becoming part of their identity. People actually felt more connected to us than to like Instagram in some ways.
But that isn't most Americans. Because let's be honest, the four of us care about, you know, people living better financial lives. Most of them care. America still lives a really horrible financial life, right?
And we can change that. All of us can change it, right?
Well, it is the promise of fintech, right?
Like, yeah.
Every company is a fintech company.
If you're not doing that, then what are we doing?
Well, no, I mean, it's like, that was kind of our goal from the start, is that I was super lucky that I had really great parents who taught me great savings habits, right? And my parents are the only reason that I got out of Louisiana and do what I do now, because they, like, literally, I mean, this is a true story. When I was 14, I started working. My mom took half my paychecks away, and I thought my mom was this mean lady that was stealing money from me.
She was stealing money from you, but...
And when I turned 18, she gave me the other half of those paychecks. And it wasn't much money. It was like $6,000, which was all the money in the world to me.
$6,000 for an 18-year-old?
That's like a lot of money. And what I did was I bought a scanner, and I started an e-discovery company, which is, you know, every 18-year-old's desire, I guess. I don't know. But,
I mean, it's my how are you single at 18 starting an e-discovery company?
I mean, but it was life-changing for me. And it was literally just the habit of, like, learning how powerful savings can be. And how that could compound. And I realized that everyone doesn't have parents like mine. Everyone's not that lucky. And so, like, that is, I think, for me, a lot of the reason that I do what I do is because I want people to learn those habits and learn the power of compound interest and learn the power of what you can do if you have those right habits. Yep. And, you know, it's like, to me, that's why I do this. It's like, get up every day.
And if you automate those habits, then more people will do it.
Sure.
Maya, what kind of feature within Fintech or kind of product category has you most excited about its potential to change the world?
That's an interesting question. Like, I think that the main problem with Americans' finances is they're not making enough fucking money. And so when we think about, like, Fintech's ability to help with that, there are opportunities. And I think, I forget the name of the company, but Atlanta-based company that, that helps with, helps people, like, find, like, gig work and, like, side hustles and stuff like that. I think that's interesting. I like the earned wage access space. Mm-hmm. I think that's interesting. I like some of the, like, short-term lending space. You know, I think, like, promising things are happening there. So I'm really interested in, like, the income side of it and less on the spending side. I think there's more opportunity there. Although I didn't know Simple let you put photos. I do like that because I feel like you can look at where your money's going and then you can decide how you feel about that. And if you're like, oh, like, this seemed like a really good idea at the time, but now I'd rather have the $25.
We never actually did that many interviews. We just looked at the photos and were surprised and then went onwards with life. But we did have people who, like, this was one use case that we actually tracked, where this dude created a $2,000 goal, which was like, I don't know, it was like a vacation or something, got all the way to the end, saved up those $2,000, then changed the name of the goal to Ring, right? And then 3 months later, there's like the $35 charge at the county clerk's office, and attached to it is a photo of him holding his wedding certificate with his wife, right?
Oh.
And we had multiple people say, like, the only reason I'm married, I'm on this track in life, is because of Simple.
But I'm curious about your analytics infrastructure. Like, how are you sourcing stories like this?
Well, you know, this was back in 2013. We may not have been as compliant with, like, the CFO may have been doing just direct queries on the database and not saying that happened. I'm not saying it didn't happen. So what's most exciting right now? Like, the core thing, right? Like, if you health and wealth, right? Like, if you want to get better health, right? Eat less and exercise more. That's basically it. If you want to get better at wealth, like, earn more and spend less. Even though those fundamental things, like fintech, really can't change that, you have to, society has to change it. The kind of the quantified self and the financial tracking can help a lot with that. The thing I'm actually most interested and excited about right now is insurtech. I look at it and I'm like, insurance is this massive industry, and there's a lot of people who should have insurance who don't have it, and yet it's sold through brokers and it's like regulated, and it doesn't even feel like it's in the 20th century. In many ways, it feels like it's in the 19th century,
yeah.
Right? And I'm like, somebody needs to fix that, and if we can actually build like so much better outcomes for people. I know this one company in South India where they would lead with, like, before they lent money to people, they would lead with accident insurance. Because they were lending to people who were, like, farmers, right, and day wage laborers. And they were like, the reason they default on a loan is because they break a leg or, they get run over or they have an accident, right? So what they would do is they'd go into a village and they would find somebody and persuade them to buy the accident insurance. And then they made a point that you just had to wait sometimes, a couple of years, somebody would actually have an accident, somebody would die, whatever. Within 36 hours, they would show up at that house and give them the cash in hand, right? And be like, if you have a loan, the loan is paid off, here's cash, you know, your grieving widow or whatever, you're in hospital, this will help. within the month after that, like half the village signed up. Right. So this sort of thing.
So your acquisition is you need to pick the person who's accident prone.
Everybody's accident prone if you wait long enough.
I think that's actually really, really powerful. And honestly, like a lot of Americans' financial insecurity is because of our healthcare system, and we don't have
a safety net. Oh, it's a pretty shitty safety net.
Yeah, and right, and it's like the healthcare. It's really such a huge component. Health insurance is wildly expensive, but
single biggest cause of bankruptcies.
Yes, exactly. As you mentioned, accident insurance, so health insurance, part of the reason it's so expensive, the bulk of that is actually like very long-term chronic diseases like cancer and diabetes and the care for that. So if you just do accident insurance, it's much cheaper.
Yeah.
I'm very interested in this space. And there's a couple, so Better Banking. So Better Banking is a challenger bank that is offering, so all of their payroll direct depositors can access $5,000 safety net of accident insurance.
Yep. Yeah.
So, and it's the exact same thing you're talking about. It's because it's parametric insurance, like they don't have to figure out anything. It's just like, boom, if you had to take the ambulance to the hospital, we send you $250 like immediately, same day. And that makes a big difference. Not have to have the adjuster come out or talk about it. Those like same day insurance payouts, I think are really powerful.
I mean, yeah, I think listening to you guys talk, actually what I get excited about is just the fact that for the consumer, this is the best thing that's happening right now, is that, like, the experience of how you deal with things is getting better. So that's actually what I'm excited about generally, is, like, what we're doing in fintech, what you're saying in insurtech, it's actually making a better experience for the consumer, which banks, frankly, haven't thought about in a really long time.
Like, in the hundreds of years.
Like accountants, because they're usually built and run by accountants, right? They're like, hey, I have a product, and I have to educate you as a user on how to buy my product and how to use it.
No, they don't even educate you. That's the funny part. It's like you have NerdWallet and Credit Karma, you go become your own analyst, and then, like, by the way, after you become your own analyst and you decided you wanted this credit card, you now go bow at the throne and say, can I please have this?
Yeah.
And you hope they say yes, and when they don't, they don't even tell you why.
Yeah. Oh, they point to a number, and you're like, I don't know where that number comes from. Like, every day right now, since we're doing this house renovation, Mint informs me that my FICO score has changed, right? And I'm just too panicked to look. It's like every day, it's like, oh shit, it's changed again.
Yeah, I mean, I talked about this yesterday, but like, my wife and I bought a house this past year, and we're very good borrowers. We put 40% down. We were terrified it wasn't going to close until the day that we closed. And that's just like, that's the system we live in. You're afraid of your bank. Like, you don't actually, like, it's weird.
I bought my condo, and I had left BBVA, and I just started up Scylla, so I wasn't paying myself a huge salary. And I couldn't.
They look at your business, and they're like, dude, your business is going out of money.
So I had to buy in cash because I couldn't get a loan. And I'm like, this doesn't make any sense.
And no, it's crazy.
Poor founders.
Well, I think this is the part that gets me excited, is actually the bundling component of it. Because right now, the point of integration is the person. Let's face it, like, even us, you know, is like, we're tech savvy, well-educated, we understand money. I still feel like I screw up the point of integration, you know, all the time. Or I'm scared of making the wrong choice, so I delay the choice, even though I know, like, I shouldn't be delaying the compounding interest, right? There's friction in doing it. And so, while you might say embedded finance is overhyped, like, embedding finance into better experiences such huge potential.
Did you say embedded finance was overhyped?
I said somebody said embedded finance is overhyped.
Oh, you walked it back, too. All right. All right.
I'm not going to walk it back.
Where's Overdorf?
So, yes. The global financial services industry is something like $17 trillion in annual revenue. Like, global GDP is like $100 trillion. And GDP is built of, like, you know, manufacturing and services, financial services, and even agriculture, right? You could argue that all the internet has done for like 25 years is completely transform advertising. Financial services is 30 times larger than advertising. Everybody from PayPal to Scylla combined is like 1% market share. It's still with 30,000 plus banks, wealth managers, insurers, and in many, many industries, you can go and look, and it's like things haven't changed at all from like 1960. And I think
we digitized it, right? It's a digital version of the brochure.
You'd be amazed how much of that shit is still paper in the background.
Yeah, I was going to say, I mean, it's true. Like, we had a slide in our Series A deck that Andreessen stole it recently and used it in one of their blog posts. But it's like, everyone talks about fintech being crowded. And I was like, look, here's all the challengers you can think of. And you put them together. This was before China got the new valuation. But at the time, it was like $26 billion of market value. Right? And then on the other hand, you look at the top four banks in the U.S., and they're worth about $1.2 trillion. You look at banks number 5 through 100, most of which are doing nothing interesting, and they're worth another $1.4 trillion. And there's still 5,000 banks behind that.
That's
so it's like, tell me, fintech's crowded? Give me a break.
Yeah. There's still more banks than fintechs in this country.
Yeah.
Right? And especially if you include credit unions, that's another 6,000 there.
Yeah.
So this decade, I think fintech and crypto and all of it together will go from like 1% to 10%. Right? And so I think by 2030, fintech will be bigger than tech was in 2010. So we'll have $2 or $3 trillion companies, probably PayPal, probably Stripe, maybe Square. We'll have like, I don't know, 50, 100 billion dollar companies, maybe Chime. And we'll have like maybe 1,000 unicorns, all in this sector. Now, tech will be much bigger. But
well, what I'm worried about is that all that growth is going to happen internationally and that the U.S. is going to be stuck where we're at because, right, it's like positioning and timing and things like that. And it's like when I go to Korea and I'm like streaming HD videos on my phone through the
or you're walking through the subway and
you can
order your groceries on the subway and they'll be delivered by the time you get home.
It's amazing. And I'm like, back where I'm from.
We actually have to pull out our phones and press buttons.
And I'm worried that we're going to see the same thing in fintech where the U.S. is still like trudging along with ACH and all that and that internationally
80% of the growth is going to happen outside the U.S. Because guess what?
Well, we're
80% of the
GDP
is outside.
Right. And places like Africa that don't have a pig are like inventing it from the ground up now today. Right. And they don't have a choice in this build versus buy, put a veneer on things.
Yeah.
So, closing round, what one piece of advice would you give, and you get to kind of choose, is it a founder, is it a developer, when they're thinking about build versus buy, what is it that one thing you would say uniquely that they should be thinking about? Zach, you want to start?
Yeah, sure.
The price you pay is not the total price. That's the short answer of that, right? And that means if you're building or if you're buying. I worked for 5 years at the CTO of an investment bank before this, and I used to have to try to explain to our founder all the time that when you build something, you now have to maintain it, too. And that is cost.
For all time.
Right. And so I think that's the short answer is, yeah, it's just like what you pay is not the price you're paying, ultimately. Maya?
Kind of opposite to that. So I really love early stage startups. I've always been like very involved in that scene. I love new companies. I think they're so fun. And so that's my advice is pay more attention to the very earliest companies because I think if you're going to buy something from the earliest companies, you basically get this dedicated subject matter expert team working for you with no commitment for a very low price. And you can trade things like, you know, put my logo on your website or on your pitch deck or like I will write you like a letter of reference for, you know, it's like you can trade.
I've helped at least 5 Scylla customers raise their seed rounds.
Oh, I'm sure. Right. Like to have, yeah. So that's
like
my advice.
Your seed round, you keep paying me, this is all good.
And don't, it's like you don't even have to look at the product, it's just the space and the problem. Because when they're so early, they'll do anything to solve problems for you. And so you'd be like, look, your product doesn't do anything for me now, but here's what I need. And you'll have an entire dedicated, sophisticated team working for you for like 5% the price it would take to hire them to get something off the ground. So that's my like.
So it's almost like the build by outsource in the Maya world, right? Which is my gain is your pain.
Yeah. That's outsourcing.
And especially today's money from Maya utilizer. I'll say think about the opportunity cost, right? Most people are like, and especially with like people, engineers who love building stuff, building back in tech like, you know, ACH processors or ledgers, this is really like the sort of like engineering challenges that you studied in engineering school maybe, and then it's fascinating. But the opportunity cost, like you, as many people have said, like building a better ledger is not going to help you validate your insurtech startup's success, right? In those first 18, 24, 36 months, it's all about what's the core proposition of the business? What's your value proposition? Can you get customers to buy into that and get to product market fit? And can you start scaling that, right? And anything that you're doing that isn't directly driving that, you've got to question that.
I think I want to build on that and say, also think about the long-term implications of the trade-off you made, because ultimately our demise for Perk Street was we took your opposite tack, which is we can't rebuild the interface. We don't have that much runway. We need to own rewards and our data around rewards and how we deliver that. We got really sophisticated. But we didn't think through that long-term process since we don't control the front end of the experience. Our ability to, you know, activate was going to be, like, we kind of knew it was a problem, but we didn't do anything to address it for the first 2 years because we were just so focused on what we had to own.
And you bought into your own hype.
It sounds like you were just a fintech infrastructure company.
Really an infrastructure company, more about NFTs and the cloud at the time. Right? But I really appreciate each of you sharing and your level of candor, you know, associated with this, and we can go, you know, back and talk some smack now afterwards.
Dorky. I've never known Maya to not have a high level of candor. So.
But I'm just looking to see what she tweets right after this.
Just was on some stage with some real idiots. I don't know.
No, you actually say that to our face all the time. So. All right. Hopefully we've kept you awake. Please enjoy lunch. We've enjoyed chatting with you.
Thank you.